I'll get back to that. But secondly, the second proposal is that we can use, we have a way that we can use biomass. We have a way that we can use the biological diversity of the planet to replace our dependence upon fossil fuels. It's a very logical assumption in a way, but the saying is that anything a dinosaur can do, so can a living plant. Anything that fossilized carbon can accomplish in terms of making fuels or plastics can be done by living carbon. And somehow all we need to do is take that living carbon and not apply biotechnology to that, but apply something called synthetic biology to this living carbon so that it will be transformed into any kind of product we want: food, fodder, fuel, plastics, pharmaceuticals, paints, whatever you need to have. It can be built from this living carbon, from the basic materials on the earth. The difference between biotechnology or genetic engineering, as we tend to talk about it, or GMOs, and synthetic biology is just enormous. We sometimes call it biotech on steroids, but it's far beyond that. With biotechnology as we've come to know it, good old-fashioned biotechnology, what you do is you move a gene from one species to another. And it's a very hit-and-miss proposition. It doesn't work well. It's sloppy. That's why they've spent the last 15 years trying to convince the world that it does work when it doesn't work. They can't do it, even with their millions of dollars of investment in public relations. With synthetic biology, they're saying, we're not going to do something stupid like move a gene from one species to another. Instead, what we're really going to do is we're going to build our own DNA. Sometimes called DIY DNA, do-it-yourself DNA. What is build it? After all, what is DNA? It's just sugars, basically. Just A, C, G, and T. You put them into base pairs, you build it up, and you've suddenly got yourself DNA. Over the last year, that's made some amazing differences in what can be done. And the investments that are going on in now in what the area of synthetic biology make biotech look incredibly small by comparison. Huge investments from the U.S. Department of Energy, huge investments from the major oil companies, huge investments from the companies you've learned to know and love through biotech, Monsanto, DuPont, companies like that. In the last year, I'll give you a couple of examples of what's happened in this field, which is, by the way, in work now. It's not something that's just theoretical, it's something which is in reality today and actually being developed in Brazil at the moment. It'll be, some plants will be opening up before Rio Plus 20 next year. What they've been able to do in the last year is, for example, show that with synthetic biology, instead of building life from in proteins from 20 amino acids, it's possible to trick the way the cell reads its DNA to create a material that uses 276 different amino acids. Suddenly, life goes from a base of 20 amino acids to 276 amino acids. That means that you can have more unnatural biological diversity in a test tube than you can have in the entire Amazon, in the entire planet. And that could be constructed. Last year, they did something else as well. What they discovered was that it's possible to build your own microbe as a living entity and to make that artificial life form self-replicating. It's never been done before in history, but suddenly in May of last year, scientists for the Synthetic Genomics Institute in the United States, company in the United States, were able to announce to the world that for the first time ever, they were able to take a template of an existing microbe, reconstruct, build it again themselves, base pair by base pair, and make it self-replicating. But it's a life form the planet has never seen before. So for the first time ever, God has competition. There's another way to build things, to do things. Those two changes during the course of last year transformed how the world, how science looks at biology. Suddenly now it's possible to say that any biomass can be made into anything, that we can design a microbe or algae that can be used to transform biomass into, again, plastics or fuels, or maybe sometimes even food. But maybe not. And that's the goal. When you talk to the venture capitalists who are dealing with synthetic biology, and this is the green economy, This is exactly the epitome of the green economy being talked about for real, plus 20. But the saying is, what we can do is with these microbes then is make anything out of anything. There's no limits. And the venture capitalists say, don't you realize that today in the world, only 23.8% of the world's annual terrestrial biomass has been commodified as part of the capitalist marketplace. Which means, from the perspective of a venture capitalist, that 76.2% of the world's annual terrestrial biomass is out there waiting to be monopolized by somebody. The proposals for the biomass economy are that. Let's take that over, and then we'll decide at harvest time whether or not that material, that biomass, will be used for food or fuel or whatever else. It's the most insidious grasp and grab, earth grab, the planet has ever seen. And it's supposed to be green and it's supposed to be good for us. The third technology that will be proposed and is being proposed now and discussed now in the United States Congress and in the UK Parliament, for example, is perhaps more shocking than that. It's called geoengineering. Not genetic engineering, geoengineering. Geoengineering is this theory, which is of course quite realistic, that after all, hey, you know, we kind of geoengineered the planet into climate change, into the crisis that we're in today. Therefore, the companies that caused the problem can now geoengineer us out of the problem. That it's theoretically possible to just tweak the planet a bit, just tweak planetary systems a little bit so that we can reduce the amount of sunlight that hits the Earth, or we can absorb carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases in the ocean. There's ways that can be done. We now have patents being granted, we now have money being spent, we now have the National Academy of Sciences in the United States and the Royal Society in the United Kingdom with documents and proposals on how they will go about doing that. How it may be possible to blast sulfates into the stratosphere to block sunlight as a kind of an artificial volcano. So you can dim down the sun just a fraction, have very nice sunsets and sunrises, and you will lower temperatures by 1 or 2 degrees. And that will buy time for other things. Or it's possible to, again, put nanoparticles of iron on the surface of the ocean in areas where there's a deficit in iron nutrients, put it there, create a phytoplankton bloom, which will then absorb carbon dioxide and sink to the bottom of the ocean. These are serious proposals. They're so serious, the United Nations even has started to talk about them. And 3 years ago now, in 2008, the United Nations Convention on Biological Diversity, 193 member countries, voted for a moratorium against any kind of what they call ocean fertilization. This idea that you can use the oceans as a sink for greenhouse gases. They said that can't be allowed. But it's a moratorium. It's not very strong in international law. It can be overturned any time. And by the way, the United States isn't a member of the moratorium. So it's still open. And a few months ago, the issue came up again before the United Nations, and again 193 countries agreed at the level of their ministers of the environment that geoengineering should not be allowed. That again, there should be a moratorium against blasting sulfates into the stratosphere or doing other of these quick fixes. But again, the United States isn't a member of that moratorium. And in fact, again, this is very soft law. It can be overturned. We believe it'll come up over the next few months. It'll be discussed in Durban. It'll go on from the Durban and COP17 of the Climate Change Convention on to Rio for the head of state discussions next summer, or next year. So again, it's an issue that is actually lively and on the table. It's not science fiction. I'll take that back. It is science fiction. But they are talking about doing it. The logic is overwhelming. It makes sense. Because, after all, they haven't done anything about climate change so far. This is the solution for a government that wants to get reelected, or an industry that doesn't want to change. And all they have to say is, don't worry, we have a technological fix that will solve the problem. We don't need to change our lifestyles. We don't need to do anything else. All we've got to do is let industry change the planet. Then everything will be okay. We've done it before, we can do it again. What's especially attractive about it is that you don't need to have the United Nations agree to it. Because a handful of countries, a handful of billionaires, can do it by themselves. It's not that expensive. You can get, and this term has been used, a coalition of the willing can be brave enough to come together and do it themselves on behalf of the rest of the planet, if we want them to do that. And that's the conversation that is taking place. That's the kind of issue that's at stake at Rio Plus 20. That's the kind of stuff we've got to be concerned about and challenging over the next few months. This can't just be some quick pass through by government leaders who are going to say, we've got a green economy now, so you can relax, don't worry, be happy. We've got these solutions, synthetic biology or nanotechnology or geoengineering. You don't have to change your lifestyle, just carry on business as usual. If you, for a moment, and I'm sure all of us here are alarmed by climate change, if for a moment you can think that the governments and the industries who have denied climate change for decades, who have refused to do anything significant about climate change for decades, who haven't even got the courage to tell their own people to take the damn bus, would ever have the integrity or the intelligence to control the planetary thermostat and do it in a way that would be just and honorable or decent for the poor of the world, for marginalized peoples? Could you ever imagine that would happen? Can you ever conceive for a moment the kind of earth grab they're proposing would ever be of any benefit to Asia or Africa or Latin America? Never. So the issue next year is not to deal simply with a party celebrating Rio Plus 20, Stockholm Plus 40, or Silent Spring Plus 50. It is to challenge not the Earth Summit, but the Earth Grab. To say, we will not allow that. We in civil society will prevent that. And we're having discussions here today, tomorrow, with all of our partners in Brazil and around the world to say, we're going to make a change. We're not going to make this happen. We're not going to let this happen. Thank you very much.
Optimistic now. That's inspiring, Pat. And our next speaker, I think many of you have come to hear her. Please come to the front if you want to come around and sit down in the front. If you're all squeezed in the back there, you're more than welcome to just walk around. There's space in the front.